Christian Wife, Christian Fellowship. We saw earlier in Acts prayers breaking bread, supporting one another, sharing spiritual things. We saw that in Acts. What about 2 Corinthians 8 and 4? Anything in there? Is that a possibility? What did you say to our sister?
Praying with us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift and take upon us the fellowship of the ministry to the saints.
Okay. Yeah. So he gives an example of believers at Macedonia, Macedonia, how that in great, verse 2, great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty, they what? Abound unto the riches of their liberality. In other words, it was a very poor group. But here's what they did, verse 4. Read that again, sister.
Praying us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift and take upon us the fellowship of the ministering to the saints.
All right, they come up with some money to say, take this to the saints. Take this to the saints. And so that's what true fellowship among believers is, that they watch out for them. You do something concrete that can be counted. So here we go. So now we'll jump into our lesson. And we'll see what the Apostle John had to say. As he writes this letter, he's no longer the young, we know John is the disciple whom Jesus loved, but he's no longer that young man. He's just grown up. He has experienced some things. He's experienced life. And from that young man, his apostleship started early in the book of Acts, we see, and he has come down to what he calls himself elder. Some church to take that title.
Elder
Jackson.
That's your title.
Can you put it on the car? Elder.
I'm just a small fish.
Look at that title, elder. So, here we go. And what will help me out with that? Give me a definition.
Elder.
What do you mean? I said Elder Jackson's car driving. Big old cat. Take up the whole ride. What do you mean by that? Elder.
Would they have a sign on his car?
Yeah.
Front and back.
Yeah. What does that mean? Anybody got any idea?
Sure.
Kenny? Brother Williams?
Well, it should mean that he's well versed in the law, in the scriptures, God's teaching.
Mm-hmm.
He's been there. He's been in God's teaching for a long time.
All right.
It was not a newborn Christian. It's someone that's been there for a while.
Okay.
And that he has wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that God has given the elders, the teachers. But now some of us use that name elder just.
Okay, so mature wisdom and wise, and this is what John is pointing out. Now, these guys that was in opposition to him in this church, they might have been some youngsters, not really mature. They could be of age comparable to John, but. John is saying, as far as the experience in the ministry, he says, I've been around. I've been around the church of Christ. And I've been around Christ's teaching. And I'm not new, raw, green. So he's saying that, as Brother was saying, I got the experience that comes from the wisdom of gathered up wisdom through the years. Mm-hmm. I think the biggest mistake that a lot of churches, and I've seen churches make, has put a youngster in a position he has no business in.
Yeah.
Oh. He can't, I mean, I don't know. 16-year-old called Preach. He's the pastor now. He's preaching to Brother Williams here. Don't tell Brother Williams how to run a marriage, how to run a house, how to run a job, how to run a business. He got all this, what? You know? And that's a big mistake. If you put a junior, in my line, junior, I mean junior in years, to over organization, entity, whatever it may be, at the wrong time. Just, you might can grow into it. Eventually, you might can get there, but you're not there yet. And it's just some things that a youngster cannot really preach a minister on. Do you agree?
Yeah.
Had a youngster tell you about, well, brother, if you lost that job, how are you going to counsel me if I get laid off? Can you say, I've been there? Or a young mother that's in, maybe that's pregnant. I've been there. Well, you haven't been there as a husband or as a wife. You haven't been there. You don't know what they're going through. So John is saying that elder, is that what he said there? Elder? The elder until the what? Well beloved. What's this guy's name? Gaius?
Gaius. He's Roman.
It's Roman, so he's Greek. He's unto Gaius, whom I love in the truth. And what he means by that is that I love you because you practice the scriptures. You apply the scriptures and you actually live the scriptures out in your daily life. All right, now. So he's faithful to the truth, but he's faithful to the scriptures. Now, and this is where we come up with one of my favorite sayings. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest what? Be in health, even as thy soul prospers. So he's writing to this person as Gaius, as being his junior. As his junior, because Gaius is also maturing to the place where John is already at in the Lord. So he's saying that as you grow in the Lord, and I want you to be healthy, and I want you to prosper as you grow in the Lord. Mm-hmm. And there's a reason why John said that, that thou mayest prosper, as you can be in health, even as you grow in the Lord. Why is he saying that? Because this whole subject of this letter is about material substance. It's about doing something that's tangible. And as we go on, we'll see here. All right, let's go with verse 3. What did he say there? Verse 3?
For I rejoiced greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, mm-hmm. even as thou walkest in the truth.
As they were walking in the truth. Now, here's something that we have today that they didn't have back in the old days. They didn't have email. They didn't have the internet to where you have instant information, communication. And if I had to, back in those days, they had people who learned from the apostles. The team, the spiritual team grew. Some of them became evangelists and missionaries and so forth, and they traveled from place to place. It took a while for the information to get back. Well, how did that meeting go? You couldn't just push a button and say email, and it went great. Telephone call, anything like that. They had to wait for the mail to travel. Or they had to wait for saints to travel from one location to the next location to get information. So he's saying that I rejoice when the brethren came back, returned from somewhere, they reported on what's going on in your church. They testified of the truth that is in thee. In other words, they said they saw that you guys practice the scriptures. Even as you, not only do you preach the scriptures, but you also walk in what you preach. Anybody ever seen the opposite? Do as I say, don't do as I do.
Yeah.
Do as I say and don't look at me too close. So he said here that they obviously you preach one way and you also live that way. It's trash or something fell off there. Okay. Now he says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in what?
Truth.
So John had to be instrumental as an apostle. As an apostle, hearing about these people whom he helped develop. Now, let me get on this right quick on this word apostle. This apostle. Anybody ever heard a preacher call himself apostle? Apostle so-and-so, apostle so-and-so. Anybody know any apostle so-and-so? Ephesians 4:11 says that God has set in the church, mm-hmm. and I think the first office was apostle. Mm-hmm. An apostle, by biblical understanding, is someone who goes about developing people in Christianity who has never heard about Christ before. That's the office of an apostle. He has no local ministry. He moves from one place to the next place, developing people who had never heard the name of Christ. That's an apostle. That's an apostle. An apostle says, I'm pastor of this local church over here. That's not apostleship. Apostleship is that I have people who I have established here, there, and everywhere, here, there, there, there. And I have to go check on them periodically to see how they're doing after I leave. I leave someone in authority over there while I go find another place to minister and preach Christ to some what Christ has never been preaching for. And I develop those people in Christianity. Is that what it says there, Brother May? What do you got? I thought you turned to Ephesians 4.
Oh, I didn't.
Okay, did anybody do that?
And he gave some apostles. Mm-hmm. And some prophets.
And some prophets.
And some evangelists. Mm-hmm. And some pastors, mm-hmm. and teachers.
Mm-hmm. He gave them different offices, and this is the order of them for his church. And that's when you have to really come to an understanding that a church is more than just a building, brick and mortar. It's an assembly of believers, wherever they assemble. And whoever founded XYZ Church is probably not the guy that's the pastor of XYZ Church. The pastorship goes down to somebody else who's able to hold things and minister things together. Mm-hmm. Teacher, totally different. All these have different, they're totally different. Okay, so that's, I don't know why I got on that, but there you go. Okay, you get that for free. So John, because he says, I have no greater love than I hear that my children are walking in truth, means that it really thrills me to know that when I'm not there, they're doing good. This is a report he got back. Well, we got to keep on going. Verse 5. What does it say? Can't be.
Beloved, thou dost faithfully whatsoever thou doest to the brethren and to strangers.
Yeah, he says that. So I know, beloved, that thou doest faithfully. Whatever you do it faithfully to the brethren and to strangers. Brethren and to strangers is the same group. The brethren in Christ that you know, and the strangers in Christ that you don't know, you treat them all the same. Okay, like if someone came to our church, like this other brother over here, what's it, who was that? I don't know. You know anybody? Maybe we'll just stand off from him today, too much body. Give him time to kind of go to get to know him. No, and we might not feed them today. I might eat too much, for all we know. We kind of keep our arms length. So, we treat all brothers, the ones we know and the ones we don't know. He says you treat them all the same. That's what he's saying. Okay, now, all right, so look at Matthew 10:40. I think he might have learned something from Jesus on that account there. If he was walking with Jesus, he might have heard Jesus say something like that. Matthew 10:40. What happened there?
He that receiveth you receiveth me, and he that receiveth me receiveth him that sent me.
Okay, so like I said, how do they communicate and do things? They get it on the traveling circuit, from one destination to the other destination, and they brought back word of how they were treated and what was really going on in those churches over there. I hear that you treat everybody good. Okay. Now, verse 6, which have borne witness of thy charity. So the report of these people saying that they saw your charity, they saw your love in action before the church, whom, if thou bend forward on their journey, after a godly sort, thou shalt do well. In other words, if you spend a little time with everybody in fellowship and treat them right, then you're doing well. Doing well. Verse 7. Go ahead, Sister Candy. Yeah, someone. I can't see that all that clear. Gotta give you some light.
Because that for his name's sake, they went forth, taking nothing of the Gentiles.
Okay, so they would not be a financial burden on the Gentiles. They didn't take an offering. Can you imagine? Preacher come to town, he don't even ask for an offering. Can you imagine that?
Today?
That's why he's not eating.
So we're going to have to hold on. We're going to have to check the
whatever. They the offering coming for the preacher.
Preacher come to town. We don't want no offering. Taking nothing. Taking nothing. It's preaching and teaching. Taking nothing. But there was a way that they got supported. And how was that? Somehow or another, there was a support system that says behind the scenes, or before you even get there, somehow or another, don't worry, preacher, we know you're out there traveling, we're going to take care of you. But when you go to that area over there and preach to those poor Gentiles, don't ask for an offering. Don't do that. Now, I know some churches that are like that, and man, they thrive big time. You know, so we take care of one another. Like the brother say, that was songs on songs, though. This is 2015. All right. Because for his name's sake. Oh, wait, is that right, King? Okay, that's right. Verse 8. We therefore ought to receive such. You ought to really receive those kind of people. That we might be what?
Fellow helpers.
We need to learn that and participate in that so we can learn how to really fellowship. Wouldn't it be nice if a preacher come to town and you don't have to worry about your pocketbook? Just hug him and love him. Oh, that's okay, brother. I'm going to go cross out and do somebody else. Just hug him and love him and feed him and, you know, fellow, hang out with him. Say, you don't have to open up our purses to him. We're just having a good time. Okay, now, so here we go. So somebody is giving the housing and the food and the finances for somebody traveling around like that. We don't know who it is, but somebody's giving them some support. But now all that's going on, remember the apostles away, but now there's somebody in the church who don't like this, having an apostle absent, spiritually absent, but with authority. But somebody in that bunch that don't like all that that's going on, probably some leader, somebody of influence, and he's going to say and do certain things when the true leader, the founder of the organization, is absent. No, nobody, that don't happen. Here's what John's going to say in his short letter. We got somebody in that church that's doing stuff like that. When I write a letter and send it to the church, even this letter that he sent to that church, somebody got in the mail room and hid the letter. Here we go. What time is that? We rolling pretty good?
Yeah, we got it.
Okay, all right. So here we go, verse 9. What did this guy do with this letter that John sent? Read verse 9.
I wrote unto the church that Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, receiveth us not.
He wouldn't receive, he hid the letter. He hid the letter. When he says receive us not, means he would not receive what we put in the letter. I, as the apostle, wrote a letter with instructions for the church, and this guy in the mail room hid the letter. Didn't want the congregation to know about the letter. Because there were some things in the letter that he wanted the congregation to do to traveling missionaries and teachers as far as fellowship goes. Because Jonah says, I'm sending them your way to teach you more about the gospel and so forth. Treat them this way, if you would. But this guy, for whatever reason, didn't want those missionaries to be treated first class. Wonder why not? Ken and I kind of talked about that this morning because this guy down further into this reading named Demetrius. What did you say about Demetrius in the book of Acts?
Demetrius was a Greek. He was the one who caused Ephesus to rise up against Paul because he was a blacksmith. And he was upset that when the ones supposed to start worshiping Christ, they didn't have him, they wouldn't ask him to make them an idol.
So they don't stay in my hotel, they can't stay. And it's really bad when you're telling them to stay in your house. And so they don't have that option. They don't have to worry about hotel fees. So you can imagine someone owns, one of the brothers in the congregation here owns a Holiday Inn. But we're telling every preacher and evangelist, we tell this brother, stay at the Jackson's house. They got it all. And this brother said, you know what? I'm missing out on some money here because you're telling him to stay over there for free. I can get him in my hotel for $100 a night. So when the announcement came to the church, he kept Sister Pearl from making that announcement that Brother So and So is coming to town. There's somebody in the church, in Christ's church, with that attitude, and this is why he had to write this letter. Read that verse again, if you will, please.
I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, who loveth to have the preeminence among them, receiveth us not.
All right. So here's what they were supposed to do at the church. And Kenny, can you read from this paragraph? Right here to about right there.
These deeds included first indulging in false and wicked innuendo, all of which was baseless nonsense. Diotrephes' criticism of John was malicious, senseless, and without substance. Second, he was guilty of not receiving the brethren, the traveling missionaries who needed aid.
This might not be in your guys' book, but it's in the teacher's book. Okay, so he started accusing John of false stuff, really was challenging his authority. He can't tell us to do that and all that. So John was saying, give him some food, give him some money, some fix him up when he come there. So this guy's, I got that at the hotel over here. They do it for free. I can't make no money. There you go.
It says third, he stopped those who wanted to welcome the missionaries from doing so.
He stopped the people in the church who wanted to welcome the missionary. He stopped them from doing so. We ain't never seen nothing like that around here, no.
And that's it. He will put them out of the church.
So this guy must have had some good role, high role in the church to take up that authority. But he definitely wouldn't let the letter get out and get out of hope. All right, okay. That's verse 10. Let's read verse 10. Wherefore, if I come, what do you say there? All right. Have I
Wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deed, which he doeth, prating against us with malicious words, and not consent therewith. Not content therewith. Neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them to do it, and casteth them out of the church.
Cast them out. So those that would do good, so he must have some authority somewhere in the church, and he's going to throw people out of the church. Wow. Okay. So, but beloved, follow not that which is what?
Evil.
But that which is good. He that doeth good is of what?
God.
And he that doeth evil has what?
No sin.
So we're saying that this guy is not saved. So would a preacher pretty much say, stand up in his congregation? I only knew one preacher in all my life that was like this. that would say, you're not saved. That's when I was in Korea. I'm bold. Said up front, you're not saved. You're not walking in Christ. You're not saved. You are not saved. You might call yourself bishop, so-and-so, and all that, but you're not saved. I know one preacher that was bold enough to do it like that. Anybody ever had a church that a preacher get up and say to this person, you're not saved. You're not walking in Christ. It's not just a difference of opinion. You're just not acting saved. Anybody? No. This is called an apostle. This is an apostle's authority. John said, when I get to town, here's what I'm going to do with that person. I'm going to publicly rebuke him. I'm going to set him straight in front of everybody. Anybody know another apostle that did something like that?
Paul.
Paul did it to who? Peter. To Peter, to another leader. Publicly. Why are you acting the way you act? You're not acting, you're not walking in the love of Christ. You're not under, you act like a Jew when you get over to the Gentiles, you eat barbecue. Come back over here, act like you're a Jew. Let me see that pig skin on your chin. Peter tried to set up and act like he never went to a Gentile home to have dinner with. And then when he gets around with the Gentiles and the Jews, he won't talk to a Gentile. Paul says, "Why you? That's you are not acting in the love of Christ." So you got to call him out. Apostles, call them out. Anybody think of another instance where the Holy Ghost called somebody not acting in the love of God? When they brought the offering, who was that that brought the offering and said that this is all we got? This is all we got. You're not acting in the, you're lying. Bam, you're dead. Boom. So, apostles and the leader's job really is to call out those that are not acting Christ-like. Because that can go throughout the whole church, that type of attitude and behavior. And you think you got a church, all you got is a little civic club. Okay. All right, so here we go. We got one other guy that was acting up. Well, let's see about Demetrius. Well, let's see how Demetrius acted. How do you say that, verse 11 and 12, Candy?
Demetrius had good report of all men,
okay,
and of the truth itself. Yea, we also bear record, and we know that our record is true.
Yeah, so this guy now, Demetrius is in your congregation. It doesn't say, but he probably had a conflict with this other guy, trying to do it right. But it says, now, but Demetrius, I get a good report about Demetrius. Bear a record. And you see how Demetrius lived. Maybe that's why people name their sons Demetrius and not this other guy.
Yeah. I'm wondering if it is the same Demetrius that was a silversmith. Maybe he got converted.
Maybe he got converted. I don't know. Okay. But Demetrius has a good report. I had many things to write. But he says, I'm so upset. I can't fit it in a letter. Wait till I get there. Anybody ever had a daddy or somebody said, don't worry about it, wait till I get home? Hope he never come home.
Yeah, I better wait more today.
Wait till I get home. You might have told your kids that. That's okay, don't worry about it. Wait till I get home. I'll straighten it out. You might have family members. Don't worry. They live out of town, acting up, cutting up. They ain't doing what they're supposed to do. Somebody not cutting the grass or mowing the field. Don't worry. Wait till I get there. I ain't gonna waste time on the phone with you. Mm-hmm. I mean, run on my telephone bill, fussing at y'all. Wait till I get there. Okay, verse 13 and 14. Okay, 14. What do you say?
But I trust I shall shortly see thee, and we shall speak face to face. Peace be unto thee. Our friends salute thee. Greet the friend by name.
All right. Praise God. So that's the display of one with authority. Somebody has to step up and put the foot in. And you got to call them out. Good.